So the other reason this is a special day is because you may be aware that we are admitting our church wardens today. Now, with it being such a strange year, this would normally happen in about May. So we're a little late. It's not our fault. We were waiting for permission. And normally this is done somewhere in the deanery and all the church wardens get together. And the majority of the congregations don't usually attend because it's in a church some miles away. And so actually, strangely, this year gives us an opportunity to thank our church wardens in a way that we don't usually have. So, you know, I think that there is a real benefit in that, and for them to be welcomed into the community that they're actually being called to serve rather than it happening some miles away. So it's really lovely to be able to do this. We have the majority of our wardens being admitted today, so that's Jamie and Kath, James, Stephen, Fiona and Penny, but three of our wardens, Robert, Paul and Liz, are going to be admitted later in the week in a Zoom service. So if anybody would like to come and support them in that, just let me know and I'll make sure that you've got the link, because it would be lovely for them to also have some support. But I know they're going to be watching this when it goes out in recording, so they will know that our thoughts and prayers are with them as well as they take on this responsibility. And we'll be thanking them properly during the service. Let's turn to our orders of service now. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. Spend a moment in quiet, bringing the past week to God. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God. Blessed are you, Lord our God, Creator and Redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image. Now through the deep waters of death, you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ your light ever dawn in our hearts, as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God, forever. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. James is going to read our first reading for us.
Testament reading is taken from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 1, verses 1 to 4 and 8 to 11. The servant of the Lord said, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall rise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We're going to listen to some music now in lieu of our gradual as we reflect on those words.
Thank you. Glory to you, O Lord.
There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. May I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I expect that many of you know the book by C.S. Lewis called The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe. Peter, Susan, Edmund and Lucy go through a wardrobe one day and find themselves in a land where it is always winter but never Christmas. It is a land of both wonders and danger, with talking animals who befriend them and teach them about their mysterious land. To the surprise of the children, they find that they themselves have been part of the mythology of Narnia for many generations. In the warmth of the beaver's cave, away from the dangers of the forest, the children learn about the ancient prophecy. When Adam's flesh and Adam's bone sits at Ker Paravel in the throne, the evil time will be over and done. They cannot believe that the prophecy refers to them. They are not, they point out to Mr. Beaver in the film associated with the book, heroes. They are just children. They are not great warriors from another world. They are ordinary people from Finchley, which is, perhaps, entirely the point. Just as the children are called to work with Aslan to usher in the new age, so we are called, like John the Baptist and Isaiah before him, to prepare the way for Christ in our own time. The temptation is to say, "Who, me?" and duck out of the limelight, and to look for someone more heroic, or more clever, or with more theological education. But if we do, then the opportunity is lost. For there are no heroes, and there are no champions for Christ's love, apart from ordinary people like us. Today, we acknowledge and give thanks for our church wardens, the people who generously take the responsibility for our fabric and our property, who work with myself and the bishop, and as the admission liturgy says, to be an example and encouragement to their fellow Christians and the wider community, and to promote unity and peace. Sounds like quite a tall calling, doesn't it? like the rest of us. I am sure they have thought, who, me? At certain times. And yet they have followed God's calling at cost of time and energy and commitment, and have kindly agreed to continue to do this in this most difficult of years. I would like to urge you to pray regularly for our church wardens and to do everything that you can to support them. The calling of some does not let the rest of us off the hook. All are called, all are chosen. Your church wardens need their church councils to be engaged and for each member of their congregations to consider what their calling is in the life of the church. It is together that we are the church, and together that we are called to bring Christ's light into the world. Our two readings today, you've probably noticed, are about calling and vocation. The prophet in our Old Testament reading from the book of Isaiah knows that he has been called by God, and he is not afraid to speak God's words to the people. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, he calls out. And he has sent me to bring good news to the poor. His news is practical. It makes a difference to the downtrodden and despairing. It is news of a new world order, where the last will be first, where they will no longer be abused or neglected or mocked, where the depressed will find new hope, and those who mourn will find courage and strength, where ruins will be built up into new, brighter cities, and where winter will finally give way to spring. Well, we probably don't identify very strongly with either Isaiah or John Baptist, to be honest. Not many of us would feel as comfortable with making quite as many enemies as they did in their steadfast determination to share God's truth. They are heroes of the faith. Perhaps quite odd heroes, really, especially John, wearing hair shirts and eating locusts and honey and shouting loudly at passers-by, caused quite a bit of consternation even in first century Palestine. And thankfully, I do think it is unlikely that God is calling us to be quite as odd as they were. But God does call us, in good times and in hard times, and often out of our comfort zone. For all of us, at this moment in time, in this season, our calling is to continue to proclaim that God is with us. Never have we needed Christmas more. Not the tinsel and the trees and the presents, though obviously they can bring much needed relief and joy, but rather we have never needed that promise more, that God is with us, God is on his way, that in Jesus we can discern some light, even on the darkest days, and that God has promised that he will always be with us, holding our hand and showing us the path to life. You are all a part of God's gift to the world. You all hold something of the light of Christ within you. Because Jesus is born each day with his people, he is found in the hope of a new start that each day offers us. Though we are ordinary, fallible children with ordinary, complicated lives, he continually breathes his life into us, loving us into expressing his love to those around us. In The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, it is ordinary children from Finchley who help Aslan to reclaim Narnia. In our own world, it will be ordinary people from Aldborough, Boroughbridge, Dunsforth, Minskin and Roncliffe who bring to life God's kingdom here and now. Extraordinary, but true. Each one of us must take up our commission to work to show the world that God is with us all. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. parish, ordained and lay, to be an example and encouragement to their fellow Christians and the wider community, and to promote unity and peace. As you come to be admitted to the office of Churchwarden, I ask you to affirm your commitment to this calling, and to seek God's grace and the power of His Holy Spirit to fulfil it. Will you, as Churchwardens, seek to work with the Bishop, your incumbent, the parochial church council, and all those who exercise leadership responsibility in your church to further the mission of God and His purposes in the world?
I will, the Lord be my helper.
Will you undertake your task as a spiritual and holy calling and seek in word and action to promote unity and peace?
I will, the Lord be my helper.
Will you care for the fabric and property of the church as stewards of God and make it your responsibility to ensure its proper upkeep and repair?
I will, the Lord be my helper.
May God be your helper and give you grace to serve Him with joy, with humility and with strength. And may your ministry as churchwardens witness to the gospel of Christ and serve the building up of His kingdom and of His church, now and always. Amen. Would you like to make your declarations, please?
I solemnly and sincerely declare before the Lord and His people that I will faithfully and diligently discharge the duties of the office of
having heard you make these declarations, I now duly and canonically admit you to the office of church warden in the parish in which you are to serve. As God has called you to this ministry, so He will not fail you. Thank you very much. And as our thanks to Jamie, Kath, Jim, Stephen, Fiona and Penny, and also for Robert, Paul and Liz, perhaps you'd like to give them a round of applause. Thank you very much. You'd like to sit down, please. Let us pray. Faithful God who centres us and calls us on, we thank you for the calling that you make on the lives of each one of us. Bless our endeavours and lead us closer to you. We pray today for all of our wardens, for Liz and Jamie, Paul and Kath, Jim and Stephen, Fiona and Penny and Robert, and we thank you for their service to your church. Help each one of us to support them in their duties and to be faithful to our own vocations. May all our churches be beacons of hope and life in a world that is often anxious and despairing, and which needs the hope of the light of Christ. May we, your people, fulfil the calling you set before us to the glory of your name and for the benefit of our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the communities that we serve, especially this morning, giving thanks for all who are supporting the vulnerable at this time of year. We give thanks for the work of Boroughbridge Community Care, all charitable and community organisations, our schools, our businesses, and our voluntary groups. We pray for all those who hold authority in our local communities, whether in elected office or by virtue of their profession or in a voluntary capacity. May we work together in discharging our duty for the good of all those whom we serve, to relieve suffering and bring hope to our town and villages. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our country at this time of medical need and political uncertainty. Grant wisdom and clarity to all in authority, and for the common good. We continue to pray for all who work in the health services and in medical research, giving thanks for the great strides that have been made and for the hope of a brighter year next year. We pray too for our media, that journalism may be undertaken responsibly and for the good of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world, especially for all those who live in countries where the pandemic has merely added to their suffering. We pray for those who are victims of war or unjust regimes, for those who go hungry, for those who are unable to access medical treatment. We ask for God's mercy where we have been complicit in maintaining an unfair world, and we ask for a more equitable distribution of the world's resources. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those in our own communities who are suffering today, for all those who suffer in body, mind or spirit, especially those known to us, including today, Joyce and John. We pray for those who have been the most isolated and lonely of the past year, for those who have been anxious, for those who have struggled to manage their disappointments, for those for whom home is not a safe place, for those whose physical health has disintegrated, and for those who grieve and who have not been able to have closure. Heavenly Father, your light comes at Christmas into utmost darkness, and you promise that there is no way you cannot reach. Heal the broken in spirit, restore the hopes of those who are despairing, and give us all the joy of your salvation. Help us to be your hands and your heart here on earth, and to point to your light and your ever-present love. As we turn our faces towards Christ, who is the light on our horizon, let us pray together with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Would you like to stand, please, and before our blessing, we'll say our creed together as we affirm our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.